Good morning. Thank you all for sacrificing your Saturdays to be here with us today. Specifically, we're going to talk about degenerative conditions of the cervical spine. So this ignores several categories of spine problems that people may have, such as trauma, inflammatory arthritis, such as rheumatoid, deformity conditions, and so forth. And we're going to focus on the most common problems that you might encounter in the community, which is myelopathy and radiculopathy, and distinguishing between the two is quite critical. I'm involved in a little bit of device manufacturing, which has been fascinating, and I also wanted to thank our sponsors once more for helping make programs like this possible. We'll first talk about anatomy and neuroanatomy. There is nothing more arcane than neuroanatomy, but we can hopefully make it useful to you clinically and leave you with a couple of things that are easy to remember and employ. And then the physical exam, and then we'll focus on the two degenerative conditions. This is the spinal cord and cross-section, and the first thing to recognize when you're considering the spine is that the spinal cord terminates at the very bottom of your thoracic spine, meaning your spinal cord connects to your brain, goes through your neck, through your thoracic spine, but then just at about the level of the bottom rib, around T12 or L1, the spinal cord itself actually ends. And that is a region of the spine called the conus. And then below that, in your spinal canal, in the lumbar spine, it is nerve roots, not spinal cord tissue itself. And that distinction is critical in terms of the types of problems you can encounter and patients' symptoms. Nerve roots, although nerves are very sensitive and nerve dysfunction at the root level can be, of course, very serious and even result in paralysis, nerve roots tend to be more resilient than spinal cord tissue. Which is why, for example, when you're operating on the lumbar spine and you need to get a disc herniation out of the way, you can gently move those nerves out of the way to access the front of the canal. Whereas in the cervical spine or in the thoracic spine, you cannot touch that structure or else you put people at risk for irreversible neurological damage and dysfunction. In this cartoon, the red tract in the spinal cord depict motor function. So what we're looking at is the spinal cord cut in cross-section, like as if you're slicing a loaf of bread. And these tracts, which are depicted here in red and blue, they're of course bilateral, but the red tracts are the motor tracts, and these are the ones that begin in the cortex of the brain, and then in the brain stem, cross sides, and then go down the spinal canal, down the spinal cord. This is why if, for example, you have someone with a stroke, they can have the stroke on one side and their motor dysfunction on the opposite side because those nerves cross at the level of the brainstem. Those nerves exit through the ventral rami after they come down and then go to the periphery to control muscles. Depicted in blue are the sensory tracts which ascend. So these tracts begin with nerve fibers in the periphery, such as in the arms and legs, or in the visceral structures, such as in the abdomen. And then they take that sensory information to the spinal cord and then go up to the brain to relay that information. The posterior columns, which are here, the back part of the spinal cord, is responsible for what's called proprioception, which is things such as your joint position sense in space, meaning you can tell without looking at it that your arm is bent, that your shoulder is up. You kind of know where your arms and legs are in space. That tract also does vibration sense and some light touch sense. And that tract ascends in the spinal cord and then crosses at the level of the brain stem to the opposite side of the brain. The tracts depicted here, which are the spinothalamic tracts, are responsible for pain and temperature sensation. And what is a little bit distinct about the wiring of those nerves is that when those sensory nerves enter the spinal cord, they cross in the spinal cord and then ascend. So there is a form of partial spinal cord injury, meaning not completely paralyzed, but partially paralyzed, where if you have a spinal cord injury to just one side of the spinal cord, you will affect the pain and temperature on one side, but you will affect the proprioception on the other side because the pain and temperature tracts cross in the cord and then go up, whereas the proprioception ascends and then crosses. The sensory fibers come in dorsally through the dorsal root ganglion here, so sensory information comes in through the back and then ascends, and conversely, motor information comes out ventrally. Moving off of the spinal cord itself to focus on the nerve roots, the cervical spine and anatomy, and the cervical spine and lumbar spine anatomy is different in a very important way. In the cervical spine, there are seven vertebral bodies, so seven levels that have pedicles, but there are eight cervical nerve roots. And so what that means, as you're looking at which nerve root matches with which vertebral body, the C6 pedicle is here, the C7 pedicle is here, and the nerve that exits above that pedicle is C7. And the reason that is at below the C7 pedicle, the C8 nerve root comes out, and then T1 is below the T1 pedicle. Conversely, in the lumbar spine, this is the L4 pedicle. The L4 nerve root exits below the pedicle, so that's an important distinction between the two when you're trying to determine a disc herniation at a particular level causing neurological dysfunction at a particular level. So again, in the lumbar spine, the nerve root exits below the pedicle. Here's L4 pedicle, here's L4 nerve root. And in the cervical spine, the nerve root exits above the pedicle. Now, in the cervical spine, those nerves exit in a very horizontal way. So if you get a disc herniation, and the disc is the shock absorber between the bones, if you get a disc herniation at C6-7, that could either be more centrally located or it could be more peripherally located. But no matter what, that C6-7 disc herniation is going to affect the C7 nerve root because that's the nerve root that exits just above that motion segment. However, in the lumbar spine, those nerves are descending and then exiting. So if you get a more central disc herniation, the nerve root at that level has already left. So here is the L4-5 disc space. The L4 nerve root is already out of the way for that central disc herniation, and the L5 nerve root would be the one that gets impinged. And the only exception to that would be a very far lateral disc herniation, which could still hit that exiting nerve root. So that's maybe a little bit overly technical, but the bottom line is a C6-7 disc herniation always hits the C7 nerve root. A L4-5 disc herniation almost always hits the L5 nerve root, so it's that lower level nerve root, but it's for very different reasons. Moving away from the anatomy a little bit and getting into components of the physical exam, those nerves exit your cervical spine, go to your brachial plexus in your shoulder, and then go down your arm, and they will typically innervate very particular areas of the skin. And so these are called dermatomes. The nerves that are the most commonly affected are C5 around the shoulder, C6, which comes down to the radial side of the forearm and hand, or the thumb side, and then C7 is really the middle finger, and C8 is the ulnar side of the hand. One way that you can try to remember this, or because it's a lot of information to take in, is if you sort of think of like the six shooter revolvers, that C6 is the thumb, so that's the thumb side of the hand. In terms of motor exam, there is a lot of overlap between which nerves go to which muscle groups. It's not really as segmented as these following slides may lead you to believe, because there's overlap. But as you're doing your motor exam, the shoulders, the deltoids, are C5, and then sensation around the shoulder girdle. C6 is biceps, a combination of C5 in that as well. It gives you sensation on the radial side of your forearm and hand, and it also gives you your biceps reflex. C7 is your triceps or elbow extension. It gives you sensation with the middle finger, and C7 radiculopathy tends to radiate down the back of the arm. And one helpful way to remember which is C7 is if you extend the elbow, flex the wrist, and extend the fingers, those are the things that the C7 nerve root does. Triceps, wrist flexion, finger extension, and it kind of looks like a 7. So you can sort of remember it that way. C8 goes to the ulnar side of the hand, and it contributes to your finger flexors, your grip strength, and then some contribution of the T1, the first thoracic nerve root, gives you your hand interosseous intrinsic strength. We'll try to apply some of those principles to the pathology that we're going to be talking about, which is radiculopathy and myelopathy. Radiculopathy refers to the symptoms that are caused by nerve root compression. So in this animation, in this picture here, we're looking at the spine in cross-section, and this is the intervertebral disc. The disc has a firmer outer layer called the annulus fibrosus and a more gelatinous inner region called the nucleus pulposus. And if you get a little rupture in the wall of that, then some gelatinous material can herniate out and impinge on a nerve root. And it's similar to if you had a jelly donut and you had a little slice in that and you squeeze, then the inner part can come out and impinge on those nerves. When the pressure is on the nerve root rather than the spinal cord, then that problem is called radiculopathy or nerve root compression. And that'll be in contrast to pressure on the spinal cord itself, which causes myelopathy, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. The symptoms of radiculopathy, almost everyone has radiating arm pain, and it's typically in that distribution of the nerve that is affected. So the common ones to get a radiculopathy are C6, so people will get pain that goes down the radial side of the forearm into the hand, the six shooter, or sometimes C7, so it'll come down the back of the hand and into the middle finger. And arm pain is the most common finding. Some will get a sensory deficit. It's not typically complete numbness. It's more of a tingling sensation or dysesthesia. Most will have neck pain because this is happening due to a degenerative process such as a disc herniation. Some will have reflex deficits or hyporeflexia, loss of reflexes. But that can be sort of hard to elicit, particularly in older people who may have hyporeflexia for other reasons such as diabetes. About two-thirds will have motor weakness, but that weakness is sometimes very dramatic, but often it's actually fairly subtle. So as you're grading motor strength, there's a 5-point scale that all of us use where 5 is completely normal. 4 is a very broad category of not quite normal, but still relatively strong. 3 means that they're able to resist gravity only, but that they cannot lift any additional weight besides just the weight of gravity. 2 means if you take gravity out of the equation, so for example, motion in this plane where you're not fighting gravity, but you can still power the joint. 1 is that there's a flicker, and then 0 is completely flaccid paralysis. That motor category of number 4 out of 5 is a very broad category, and so when you're meeting patients and examining them, it's really not adequate to just kind of have them move their ankles up and down. You really have to have them resist you. And sometimes patients will notice that there is a strength deficit that is difficult for us to detect. For example, younger guys who like to exercise will say, I'm trying to do push-ups and that one arm, there's something wrong with the triceps. And then you examine them, it's hard for you to elicit that yourself, but patients will sometimes tell you. Most of these patients, or at least half of these patients, will also get some shoulder girdle pain. So not only will they have the pain that radiates down the arm, but they'll get some periscapular pain because the nerves go to that region as well. And occasionally they will get headaches, particularly in the upper cervical nerves, that some of which wrap around the base of the skull. What is depicted here in these animations, this is called the shoulder abduction sign. And when someone has a disc herniation pushing on a nerve, they can take the pressure off that nerve a little bit by going like this. It rather than having gravity pull their arm down, which tensions the nerve across the disc herniation and hurts. Going like this feels better. And patients may not even notice that they're doing it, but if you interrogate them a little bit, they say, you know, I drove into the office with my hand on the back of the car seat like that because it felt better. Or I've been sleeping like this a lot, for example. This maneuver here is called a Sperling's maneuver, where if you rotate the head in the direction of the disc herniation and tilt back in this position, that will cause a shock of electrical pain down the arm. And the reason that elicits symptoms is the nerve is exiting through a foramen and the disc herniation is sitting just in front of that nerve. And if you rotate the neck in that direction, then it brings the disc herniation back onto the nerve and causes the radiating arm pain. What makes spine particularly, or one of the things that makes spine a little bit challenging or complex is, of course, those nerves then exit into the arm, and there's, as we heard earlier today, a whole host of problems that can cause arm pain or leg pain. So you can have a shoulder problem, which could be a rotator cuff tear, or it can be a C5 radiculopathy. Those nerves are exiting through the brachial plexus and going down your arm, and so here's your carpal tunnel right here. You can have a C6 radiculopathy that sounds very similar to carpal tunnel. You can have cubital tunnel, which is the ulnar nerve compressed at the elbow, versus more C8 pathology, numbness in the small fingers. And there's various ways to figure out which it is, typically either a cervical MRI if you're more suspicious that it's the neck, versus an EMG nerve conduction study if you're more suspicious that it's peripheral nerve root entrapment. Or sometimes it can be both. This is an MRI in cross-section. And this panel is normal. The area that you should focus on is right here. So imagine we are standing at this patient's feet and slicing them like a loaf of bread and going straight up the spinal canal. This is the spinal cord in cross-section. It looks like a dark olive. This is the vertebral body or disc space. This is the front, and this is the back. And then these are the posterior elements. And you can see in this depiction, there's white spinal fluid that is all the way around that spinal cord. Nothing is compressing it. And if you squint, you can even see that dorsal ramus and ventral ramus that is making the nerve root and then exiting through this foramen. So at each level, a nerve root exits through this passageway here. This is the right side, and this is the left side. You have to imagine that you're standing at their feet and looking up at their spinal cord. This is what a disc herniation looks like. So again, here's the spinal cord, and this person is fortunate that they have a very wide or capacious spinal canal. That disc herniation, which is right here, is not impinging on their spinal cord, but you can see how it would impinge on the nerve root that's trying to get through this foramen, which is right here. On the right side, it is wide open and normal, but on the left side, you're getting nerve root compression from that disc herniation. This is the other view that's useful, which is the sagittal view or the side view. And to orient you, the base of the brain is here. These are the vertebral bodies that are lighter, bone looks light. The disc spaces are these little dark structures here. This is not quite in the midline, so you don't get all of the spinal cord coming down. It's just a little off center, but you can see a disc herniation, which is bulging back from this disc space and into the canal. And then this is what a cadaver specimen would look like, where the wall of the disc has ruptured and some of that inner gelatinous material called the nucleus pulposus has herniated out and is causing pressure. When we see this problem, and it's a fairly common problem to have, particularly in people who are in their 30s or 40s, as long as they don't have any profound neurological deficits such as severe weakness, it is okay to treat these people conservatively. And the natural history of a disc herniation is about 80% of them, or possibly more, get better on their own over the course of a couple of months. When you meet these people for the first time, they are absolutely miserable because that disc causing pressure and inflammation on the nerve is very painful. And they would let you cut their arm right off to get rid of that pain. But the right thing to do is sort of put the brakes on everything, see if you can make them comfortable for a couple of months to see if the disc herniation is going to go away on its own. And the first line treatment for that is anti-inflammatory medications. oral steroids like a Medrol dose pack or prednisone taper, physical therapy, which can help with some of the muscle spasms. And if that's not working, then potentially epidural steroid injections, which Dr. Turan specializes in, as a way of by helping them stay comfortable while you wait to see if the disc herniation is going to go away on its own. If that disc herniation doesn't go away over the course of about 2 months, then surgery could be an option for those patients to take the pressure off of the nerve and make them feel better. However, when the issue is nerve root compression, not spinal cord compression, which we'll be talking about in a moment, when it's nerve root compression causing radiculopathy, there's no emergency or urgency to that problem, and it's okay to wait them out. And some patients will choose to wait or live with it, and it does not typically cause progressive neurological dysfunction. So if patients have waited that disc herniation out and maybe they got a little bit better, but they didn't get 100% better, they still have some symptoms, surgery at that point is still completely elective. Even though we are talking about spinal cord and nerve roots, surgery is elective for them in the same way that if they have terrible hip or knee arthritis, they could choose to live with it or they could choose to have a joint replacement for symptom relief. The only exception to that would be if there was a significant neurological dysfunction, like a bad motor weakness, then you might be prompted to be a little bit more surgically aggressive and just take the pressure off so they have the best possible chance of a neurological recovery. There are a couple of ways to fix this problem surgically. You can either approach it from the front or approach it from the back. The best way to take a disc herniation out, though, is to go where the problem is, which is in the front. And traditional surgery for this is called an anterior cervical discectomy infusion, or ACDF. And this operation is very reliable, has been around for many decades. And in this procedure, you get a small incision in the front of the neck. From there, you can gently move all of the soft tissue structures out of the way. So there's the trachea and esophagus, which are moved toward the midline, the carotid sheath, which has the carotid artery, which is gently moved laterally. And without having to cut through or transect anything, you can bluntly dissect and get to the front of the spine. And then from there, you take the disc out, and you can reach all the way back from the front of the spine into the spinal canal and take away any disc herniation. And then you put some form of a graft, and those grafts can be either bone, the patient's bone, or cadaver bone, or they can be something synthetic, plastic, such as PEEK, or even the very newest rendition of this, which is metal spacers, that will, once the offending disc is taken out, you have to hold that space open. That also allows you to indirectly decompress. So here's the nerve root coming out right here. You can indirectly decompress that by holding the space open a little bit taller. Imagine putting a little car jack in there and ratcheting it up a little bit. That gives you better cranial, caudal, foraminal decompression of that nerve root, in addition to the direct decompression that you're doing by going in and taking all the little bone spurs off of the nerve. Typically, in addition to putting the spacer in, you have to then stabilize that with a small plate and screws. And this is what a one-level ACDF looks like that is fused. The bone graft had been here, but at a year or so, it is essentially indistinguishable from the bone above or below. So that's a successful fusion. An ACDF is a very reliable operation, and it's still the workhorse for this type of problem. But it's not completely foolproof. In the long run, there's two things that can go wrong. One is it could fail to fuse, and that's called a non-union. The risk factors for non-union, by far number one, is smoking. So if you have a patient with this problem, it is much better if you can get them off of all nicotine products for a minimum of about 6 or 8 weeks prior to surgery, because it improves their chances that the fusion will succeed. The non-union rate in a one-level ACDF in a healthy non-smoker is very, very low. It's less than 5%. But if they smoke, that non-union rate goes to maybe 20%. And if you're doing multiple levels, you're talking about a failure rate of around 50%. And it's such a problem that quite often insurance companies will not approve that operation in the setting of smoking because they don't want it to fail. The other problem that can happen is what's called adjacent segment degeneration, where you get a successful fusion, but over the course of years, the segment above or the segment below now has more biomechanical stress on it, so it can degenerate, wear out, and become symptomatic. And the rate of that happening is 2.9% per year for 10 years. And that sounds like a small number until you go out 10 years and it's 29%. people needing a second operation for the adjacent level. So it's a fairly common problem. And this type of pathology typically happens in younger patients, so people in their 30s and 40s who may have an additional 40 or 50 year life expectancy in front of them. The adjacent level can be, in my opinion, the primary concern if they're deciding whether or not they should have an operation. There is motion preserving technology which tries to accomplish the same goal but avoids the risks of failure to fuse and avoids the risk of adjacent segment degeneration. And that's called a disc arthroplasty. And that is a joint replacement similar to a hip replacement where you have a sort of a ball and socket joint. This is made out of plastic and this part is made out of metal. And then it can move and it can preserve that 7 degrees of motion per motion segment. And this is what it looks like on X-ray. The cervical disc arthroplasty is relatively new technology, at least compared to ACDFs. We have very compelling evidence that goes out to about 7 years, meaning for the 7 years that we have followed these since the first were put in, people have equivalent relief in their radiculopathy compared to an ACDF. So it does preserve the motion. They will still have the 7 degrees of motion per segment. But the reoperation rate is 4 times lower because they don't get non-unions and they theoretically, at least, decrease the adjacent segment degeneration. The problem with cervical disc arthroplasty is, number one, we don't know how it behaves in the long run. Our experience with hip replacements is that plastic can wear out and sometimes it then needs to be revised. And doing that in your hip is bad enough, but doing that next to your spinal cord is even riskier. We believe that the disc arthroplasties don't really wear out the same way because your head and your skull only weighs 12 pounds. So it's a very different amount of stress compared to a hip replacement or the lumbar disc arthroplasties, which we had tried about 8 years ago and mostly moved away from because they wear out. The other problem is some of these do in fact fuse even though they're not supposed to, so it ends up behaving just like an ACDF, which is not necessarily a bad problem. It's just that you lose that little bit of motion. I want to shift topics slightly from nerve root compression, which is radiculopathy, to spinal cord compression, which when that's symptomatic, that's called myelopathy, and it's a completely different entity. Stenosis in the cervical spine or in the lumbar spine, what that means is that spinal canal through which the spinal cord or nerve roots pass is smaller than it should be and is impinging or squishing the spinal cord. So in this depiction here in cross-section, this is the spinal cord and there's space all the way around it. That spinal cord has no compression on it. Versus here, that spinal cord is being compressed by structures in the front, such as the disc, or structures in the back if the facet joints here become arthritic, or if you get hypertrophy of the ligament that's on the inside of the spinal canal, which is called the ligamentum flavum, then you can get that circumferential compression on the spinal cord. And here's what it looks like in MRI. This is a normal where the spinal cord is surrounded by white spinal fluid and there's plenty of space. And then here you can see that space is encroached upon, causing circumferential spinal cord compression. And in this animation, which is has been applied over an MRI, you can see how that spinal cord compression or that circumferential compression could affect the spinal cord. When you're looking at imaging, there is a couple of ways to diagnose stenosis or spinal cord compression. Historically, based on X-rays, what we used to use was this ratio called the Torg-Pavlov ratio, where if you're looking at a lateral X-ray, or now with MRI or CT scan, it can be applied as well, and you're just sort of eyeballing things and trying to determine if this person has stenosis or not, the width of the vertebral body, which is here, should be approximately the same as the width of the spinal canal. So if you measure this distance, the width of the vertebral body, and this distance, the width of the spinal canal, they should be the same. If the width of the spinal canal is narrower than the width of the vertebral body, then that is stenosis. And less than 0.8, meaning the canal diameter divided by the vertebral body diameter, that ratio, if it's less than 0.8, then that defines the stenosis. Some people are born with stenosis. That is called congenital stenosis, which just means that the way they are built, their spinal canal is a little bit narrower. And that may not be symptomatic ever throughout the course of their entire life, but you'll see it found incidentally on imaging. For those patients who may be completely asymptomatic, they need to at least know that that problem is there because they should avoid high-risk activities. The reason being that spinal cord doesn't have a lot of space in the spinal canal, so if they were to have a fall or a car accident or something like that, they could become quadriplegic from that, where the rest of us might be okay because our spines are okay. So it's somewhat controversial, but if you find someone with significant stenosis, they probably shouldn't be playing contact sports like football. They probably should not be riding a horse. I caution them against skiing, motorcycles, and things like that. The Torg-Pavlov ratio is an X-ray measurement. Now that we have MRI, we are able to much more precisely measure things. And the normal average spinal canal diameter in the cervical spine is around 18 or even 20 millimeters. That's normal. When you get a canal diameter, meaning this diameter right here, less than 13 millimeters, then you have stenosis. And that's relative stenosis. When it gets to less than 10 millimeters, then you have quite significant stenosis, and someone with a canal less than 10 millimeters, the chance of them having a problem during the course of their life is actually fairly high as a result of that. Cervical stenosis from degenerative changes, so not the congenital form where you're maybe born with a slightly narrowed canal, but the degenerative changes such as degenerative disc changes or arthritis in the facet joints that leads to spinal canal compromise, that is the most common cause of spinal cord dysfunction in people over the age of 50 by far. And although it is extremely common, it is not frequently recognized because the symptoms, which we'll get into in a moment, can actually be fairly subtle. But when people think of spinal cord injuries, they're thinking of young people that jumped off of a diving board or in a car accident or quadriplegic, and those are fortunately very rare. Spinal cord dysfunction from cervical stenosis is far more common and harder to pick up. Myelomalacia is an MRI finding which refers to signal changes in the spinal cord. If that spinal cord, and here's a side view or a sagittal view, if that spinal cord has been critically squished for a long period of time, then you'll get a light spot in the spinal cord, which is called myelomalacia. And that is evidence that the cord is ill from all of this compression. It predicts negative outcomes regardless of surgical versus non-surgical management. The symptoms of cervical myelopathy, as I described, are fairly subtle, which makes it, in my opinion, a fairly dangerous problem to have, because these types of degenerative conditions typically happen to people who are a little bit older, in their 60s, their 70s, their 80s. And some of the things that we will kind of write off as, oh, that's just old age, is not necessarily just old age. It could be spinal cord compression. So things like balance problems. You'll find people walking with a very wide-based gait because their balance is off, or they're requiring a cane or a walker for balance problems that are not clearly understood. It could certainly be from spinal cord compression. Additionally, they can get some hand clumsiness, so their fine motor skills, their ability to do their buttons on a shirt or put an earring on or something like that is diminished. They may get urinary retention, which then results in urinary incontinence from overflow incontinence because the bladder sphincter does not the sphincter does not relax, so the bladder fills up, and then the bladder can only fill so much, so they begin to dribble, and that's overflow incontinence, which can sometimes be from spinal cord dysfunction. And then they will also get numbness in their hands, or burning palms is another fairly common problem. So you can see how each of these, when they're not, if the symptom's not too dramatic, that's something that say, oh, grandma's just getting old, she's dribbling a little bit, she can't turn a key to open a door, and her balance isn't good. But every single one of those can be from spinal cord compression, and that's an extremely common clinical scenario. You get stepwise deterioration in neurological function. So when you identify someone with cervical stenosis and myelopathy, which is these symptoms that I described, some of them will stay like that their entire life, but at least 50% of them will tend to gradually worsen in a stepwise fashion. And what I tell all of these people is, if you were to have an operation for this, we're not operating on the spinal cord. You can't undo damage that has already been done. You can halt neurological worsening and thereby preserve function. We do actually find that, particularly if the stenosis is in the more mild or moderate range, they can, about half of them will get some neurological improvement, but some of them don't. And if you do an operation on these people and they don't get better, but they also don't get worse, that is a surgical success in this setting. Because if you fail to act or don't do anything, then they get stepwise progressively worse. The other thing to keep in mind is they can get what's called tandem stenosis, which means if you have stenosis in your low back, there's a fairly high likelihood that you'll also get stenosis in your cervical spine. The symptoms of cervical myelopathy are a little bit different from radiculopathy. So radiculopathy, which is nerve root compression, you might have diminished reflexes. But in spinal cord compression, you get an increase in reflexes, or hyperreflexia. So for example, you're tapping at the triceps or the wrist, and you get sort of a very exaggerated or a 3+ reflex. In my opinion, reflexes that are diminished or absent don't really mean that much. It's almost irrelevant, because so many people with diabetes have diminished reflexes, or if they've had a total knee replacement, you're not getting a reflex at the patella. However, brisk reflexes, hyperreflexia, is extremely significant, because it suggests that there is an upper motor neuron, meaning brain or spinal cord compression, that's causing the problem. Hoffman sign, what that means is, if you stabilize their finger at the and allow just the DIP joint to move, or the very last motion segment in the finger, you stabilize that and then you sort of flick the finger, you will see the other fingers reflexly contract a little bit. And that can be fairly subtle. The reason that and these other reflexes happen is they are what are called primitive reflexes, which means brand new infants have all of these reflexes, and then as your brain and spinal cord and nerves mature, then they get suppressed. In growing children and adults, those primitive reflexes are suppressed. When you have bad spinal cord compression, then that suppression of those primitive reflexes goes away, and you'll find things like that again. Clonus refers to an ankle reflex, where if you lay a patient down on a table and then you just dorsiflex their ankle like this, you will see multiple beats of sort of a flapping ankle, and greater than 3 is abnormal. So even someone who is neurologically normal can have 2 beats of clonus. That's okay. But in profound myelopathy, you will dorsiflex the ankle and they will keep going like that for a while, and that's another sign that the spinal cord is being compressed, either in the cervical spine or the thoracic spine. Tandem walking, what that refers to is the heel-toe walking, like if you were ever pulled over for drunk driving, not that any of you have been, but it's a balance test. And most adults should be able to walk heel-toe without staggering or requiring assistance or anything like that. And if their balance is off, then it's definitely worth looking at their cervical spine. And then lastly, Lehermitte sign. What that means is if you flex and extend the neck back and forth a couple of times, they get electrical shocks down the arms. The process that is myelopathy, if they are symptomatic, in my opinion, they really should have an operation. You will find people that have cervical stenosis that are asymptomatic, and it is absolutely okay to just observe them. Or if they are very minimally symptomatic, maybe a little bit of burning in the palms or something, then it's okay to watch them closely. But again, remember, they can get stepwise deterioration. So if they begin to neurologically worsen, then that is the time to act. If you find these people so neurologically devastated already that they are now in a wheelchair, the chance of you being able to reverse that and getting them out of a wheelchair because of their proximal muscle weakness is unlikely. So cervical stenosis causing myelopathy, if they are symptomatic, it is really a surgical problem. And in my opinion, and no offense to all the physical therapists in the room, it would be inappropriate for prolonged conservative management. That is completely different from radiculopathy, which we talked about earlier, where therapy is safe and effective, even if they don't necessarily get better, you haven't burned any bridges by waiting things out. traditional surgery for cervical stenosis can be done either from the back or from the front. What you see here is a posterior operation called a laminectomy infusion. So this here is the spinal cord, and then you're seeing the metal on either side, which is these lateral mass screws, which go into the vertebral bodies to hold it still. And then we put bone graft down to help it fuse. And this is what an x-ray looks like with the screws going here into the pars or here into the lateral mass to stabilize that. Sometimes the compressive problem is more in the front. And for example, in this case where the cervical spine, to orient you, the skull is here, the face is here, so that this person is tilted forward in what's called kyphosis. If you were to do an operation in the back and just decompress from the back, that spinal cord is still draped across those compressive structures. So if they're kyphotic like this, then you really have to approach it from the front to take the pressure off from the front. Here's the MRI of the same. You can see the myelomalacia, the cord signal change right here, and you can see the thinning of the spinal cord as it drapes over the subaxial cervical spine. And here's a position that you'll sometimes find where people can, from things like rheumatoid arthritis and so forth, have sort of a chin on chest deformity. And if the problem's in the front, then you have to work in the front. And this is called a corpectomy. It's essentially an anterior cervical discectomy infusion that you have made bigger and taller to take out all of the compressive structures. And there are various types of things that you can put in, either bone, plastic, or metal with bone graft. And then typically you would also stabilize with some form of a plate in the front. Sometimes if people have very involved disease at multiple levels, you would approach both from the front and from the back. So this was a case I did just a couple of weeks ago where this was someone who historically had smoked and had four-level disease. If you do a four-level ACDF, the chance of that person getting a non-union is very high. So you would often back it up by going in from the back. And I also felt that I couldn't address all of the compression from the front. Some of the compression was coming from the front. Some of the compression was coming from the back. So this was a front and back operation where here are the ACDFs. You can't see the plastic, but you can see the little metal screws. And then after we did the front part under the same anesthetic event, we went from the back, did the laminectomy, and put those screws in. And that's that type of a very big operation is certainly less common, but is something that will deploy for very involved disease. There is, for this, a motion-preserving alternative as well called a laminoplasty. And in a laminoplasty, so here's the spinal cord, here's the vertebral body with the disc space. That spinal canal, which is a tube of bone, if you make a little hinge on this side, and then you prop it open, and this what you see in purple here is a little plate, essentially what that laminoplasty is doing is taking the spinal canal like this and opening it like that. And that is motion preserving in the sense that it does not span any motion segments, so people don't really lose their neck motion. But it does an equivalent job in terms of taking the pressure off of the spinal cord for halting neurological progression or sometimes getting some neurological improvement. This is what it looks like intraoperatively with a metal plate, one at each segment. And you can see just a little bit of the spinal cord that is under there. And then this is all bone. This is that roof that's been elevated like that. And here are the x-rays where you can see the tiny metal plates, one at each segment. This is only appropriate if someone has the right neck alignment. So again, if they are tilted forward, then opening the spinal canal in the back won't work because the spinal cord will not drift off of those ventral structures. But if they have normal lordosis or a normal curvature in their neck, which is more of a tilted back posture, then laminoplasty can be a good option. I trained under Dr. Heller, who helped develop these plates, and we did a lot of laminoplasties in my training. The neurological outcomes are very, very good, equivalent to the other things that I've showed you, but the complication rates are lower and motion is preserved. In wrapping things up, I want to make a plug for our spine meeting. We have a group which is called the Plymouth Spine Society. Many of you are already participating in it. But every other month, particularly when the weather kind of takes a turn for the worse, so starting in a couple of weeks, we meet up in the evening. Anyone who has an interest in spine, be they physicians, chiropractic, therapists, nurses, or anyone involved in spine care is welcome. Membership is free. And we typically do sort of a social hour where you can meet colleagues who do the same type of thing as you. And then we'll have some type of a lecture, something that's of interest to the group. So our next one is on November 17th. Everyone is welcome. And if you're interested, let me get you on the email list. Just come find me afterward. And that concludes my thoughts. Thank you.